others must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one, and shall share in the lamb in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, and then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night they shall eat its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it, with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. You shall eat like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt, I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our blessing compass of communion with the blood of Christ. Our blessing compass of communion with the blood of Christ. How shall I make a return to the Lord for all the good he has done for me? The cup of salvation I will take up, and I will call upon the name of the Lord.
Praise to you. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to hand him over. So, during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God, he rose from supper and took off his outer garments. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put his garments back on and plied the table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord. There's a long tradition in literature with the search for the Holy Grail, this magical item. So in the Arthurian legends, King Arthur sends his knights out to find this grail to heal his sick kingdom. Or more recently, Indiana Jones in The Last Crusade, they search for the Holy Grail that heals one of the characters and may even give eternal life. This chalice linked to healing, to life, even eternal life. And what the Holy Grail is in all these stories is the chalice that Christ used at the Last Supper. The Last Supper is what we celebrate tonight, this Thursday before Easter, this last meal with the apostles, where Jesus and the apostles celebrated Passover. So Jesus celebrates his Passover meal, which itself is celebrating the time of Moses in Egypt, right before the Exodus. If you remember that God was sending these plagues upon Pharaoh so that Pharaoh would release the Israelites that were held in slavery to the Egyptians. And that this last plague that God was going to send upon Egypt, he said that all the firstborns would die. But he told the Israelites to sacrifice a lamb and put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost so that the angel of death would go over their homes when he came to exact this last plague. And they ordered the Israelites to eat this lamb they had sacrificed, with ready to leave in the morning when Pharaoh would free them. In Jesus' time, thousands of years later, the Jewish people at that time would celebrate every year this Passover meal. And Jesus chose this meal as his last supper. And this tells us a lot because he didn't pick it randomly. So at that meal in Jesus' time, they would have the lamb sacrificed in the temple in Jerusalem. And then at this meal, they would eat the lamb and there would be four toasts from a chalice, the Holy Grail, the chalice that was used at this meal by Christ. And what they were doing was not simply remembering what happened all those many years ago with Moses, but they were in a way taking part in that freedom granted the Israelites from Egypt. And all of that in the Old Testament Passover is a foreshadowing of what Jesus is doing at this meal of the Last is the lamb that will be sacrificed to bring freedom to his people. The bread and wine are mentioned in the meal, yet the true sacrifice is Christ himself, freeing us not from the tyranny of some pharaoh thousands of years ago, but the ultimate tyranny of sin and death itself. That Christ, after this meal, is going to enter upon his passion, where he dies for us on the cross, and he's going to rise again on Easter Sunday. And all of this is part of this meal, this sacrifice that Christ is doing, so that they can understand what Christ is about to do. His apostles can see that he's going to bring salvation, union between man and God again, to lead us to our true homeland, the fulfillment of the whole Exodus story in the Old Testament. And here's the thing, just like the ancient Israelites would celebrate the feast of Passover and take part in it, Christ here intends for us to take part in this Last Supper, not just tonight, where we celebrate it in a special way on the day in which it took place, but in every single Mass. That's why at every Mass, the priest says, "Behold the Lamb of God, the Lamb that was sacrificed to forgive our sins." That the events of the Triduum, these three holy days of Christ's passion and resurrection, we relive each time we go to Mass. They are made present to us, and we share in the grace in God's own life that he gives us through this event. And so one way to put it theologically is that Christ instituted the Eucharist, that he created the sacrament of the Mass here on this Last Supper that we celebrate tonight. And he also instituted or created another sacrament, that of holy orders, that of the priesthood that he created at this meal. This was the ordination of the apostles who joined the Last Supper with Christ. He ordained them so that they could fulfill their mission to bring this sacrament, this Last Supper, the Mass, to all the people that would follow after, so that after the apostles and the bishops that followed in their footsteps, that line from the apostles then to the bishops and priests today, that this meal would be given to us, the Eucharist, that we can share in the graces, that we can take part in this event that frees us and yet happened thousands of years ago. This is the center of our faith, the sacrament to join us to this great salvific act of Christ and the grace that was won for us. And yet, in a way, that's what's funny about these stories of the Holy Grail. They're always phrased as a search for the Holy Grail. But the true Holy Grail, the grail that Christ, the chalice that Christ used, is present in every Mass. We don't have to go search ruins and historic areas. We don't have to go to archaeological sites to find this chalice. It's present in every single Mass we go to. And yet there still, in a way, is a search for the Holy Grail. Because I can't help but realize, looking out, I stand in an empty church, empty row upon empty row of pews, that I'm talking to a cell phone on a stick in this moment. The only people here are sitting behind me. And so here I am preaching about the Mass, and yet there are no public Masses in this land. And so for us, this is a moment where we engage in that search for the Holy Grail. You know, there's a lot of different versions of this, the search for the Holy Grail, but my favorite one that I think sheds light upon this is there's a medieval quest for the Holy Grail written by an anonymous monk, probably a Cistercian monk, and he subverts the whole genre because in the stories, the legends of King Arthur, they're full of brave acts of chivalry, of knights winning jousts and saving damsels in distress and doing all these heroic acts. And yet this monk subverts all of that because in his version of it, whenever the knights sent out by Arthur to find the Holy Grail, to heal his kingdom, whenever they engage in fighting, in acts of knightly bravery, it always goes poorly. They always end up killing plenty of people, but never finding the Grail. They never never advance the quest through their human might and strength. And there's these moments where they call up the holy men to see why they weren't able to find the Grail. And it's always brought to them by the holy man that its quest is not one of physical bravery and might and power, but it's a spiritual quest to find the true and living God. And in this time, we find ourselves separated from the Last Supper, separated from the Mass. It's a time to have that interior search of the Holy Grail, to grow in desire for what God wants to give us. Because as we grow in that desire, when we do return to Mass, when we can fill these pews again, that desire will lead us to obtain even more grace. Because God only gives what we're willing to accept. So use this time to read the Gospel, the Passion narratives, what Christ is going to do in these 3 days. Grow in that desire and knowing what God has done for us. And as we grow in that desire and use the graces of this most holy season, that we will find that we're finding the true Grail. When we come back to Mass and drink from that holy Grail, the chalice, we'll find that God will transform our hearts and our minds and make us true children of God. Trusting in God's love and mercy, let us bring our petitions before Him. For the Holy Church in this time of trial, that all the members of the body of Christ may draw closer to the graces of the season and be transformed and healed by our Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our bishops, priests, deacons, religious, that they may be follow God in this time and serve the church well. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of our country, that they may act with wisdom and prudence, and that they may follow God in this difficult time. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our parishioners, our families and friends, that this may be a time of great grace, and that they may grow in deeper love for God and each other. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And especially at this Mass, for the repose of the soul of Thomas Caulfield, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the souls of the faithful departed, that they may enjoy the vision of God's face, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, we ask all these things in your name. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for to your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for to your goodness we receive the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as a saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong, and as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you as we observe the day on which our Lord, Jesus Christ, handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer for our salvation, You, O God, as Almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium Fidei.
By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all.
peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Agnus Dei.
Quis tollis peccata mundi. Miserere nobis. Agnus Dei. Quis tollis peccata mundi. Miserere nobis. Agnus Dei. Quis tollis peccata mundi.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to be shed under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
This is the body that will be given up for you. This is the chalice of the new covenant in my blood, says the Lord. Do this whenever you receive it in memory of me.
Let us pray. Grant